This video is brought to you by CuriosityStream. By signing up to CuriosityStream with the link in the description, you'll also get access to Nebula, where you can watch my original series, Led Zeppelin's Epics. Find out more after the video. One of the strangest, most exciting scenes in music history was undoubtedly the 1960s psychedelic scene. It's a period we still look back on through rose-colored glasses today. It was a period full of experimentation. Experimentation with love, experimentation with drugs, and of course, experimentation with music. In a lot of ways, the 60s cast a shadow that we're still standing in to this day. And if you could distill that entire movement down into just one song, it might be White Rabbit by Jefferson Airplane. That song tapped into the pulse of an era. It put iconic lyrics together with experimental music and created a song that still conjures images of a time and a place half a century later. Let's take a closer look. It was 1963 and the patent for LSD had just expired. It wouldn't be made illegal until 1966, and so it was taking America's West Coast by storm. Caught up in this storm was Grace Slick, who was living in San Francisco at the time. One day, she decided to drop some acid and listen to Miles Davis's classic album, Sketches of Spain. She listened to the album over and over for hours, letting Miles Davis's smooth, Spanish-inspired sounds guide her trip. And in her mind, her first great song began to gestate. It wouldn't come to fruition until a few years later, though. In the fall of 1965, Grace Slick formed a band with her husband at the time, Jerry Slick. That band was called The Great Society. They fooled around in the San Francisco psychedelic scene, gigging and writing a few songs through the fall. Then one winter afternoon, Grace Slick was home alone, and she began to write lyrics, reading them aloud as she did. These lyrics were inspired by Alice's Adventures in Wonderland, one of Slick's favorite stories growing up. But they weren't exclusively based on the story. They also tapped into the world around Slick, particularly by referencing drugs. Drugs were everywhere in the 60s, but not just the younger generation's LSD and marijuana. The older generation were taking their own drugs too, prescription pharmaceuticals like Valium and Miltown. The opening lines of Slick's lyrics evoked both these drugs and the growing generational divide.
One pill makes you small, and the ones that mother gives you.
With the lyrics written, Slick started to write music to the song, thinking back to that day listening to Sketches of Spain. The influence is abundantly clear. Just listen to how the intro of White Rabbit sounds like Soleil. The early version of the song was different though. It was 6 minutes long and more open, featuring loose jams. While the song was developing, however, the Great Society broke up. Some of the members moved to India to learn sitar, but Grace Slick was recruited by another Bay Area band, Jefferson Airplane. Slick brought a few songs from the Great Society, including White Rabbit. With Jefferson Airplane, the song got honed into its final form and recorded on November 3rd, 1966. When they released it as a single in June of 1967, they kicked off one of the most important summers in American history, the Summer of Love. Hippies from across the world made pilgrimage to San Francisco's Haight-Ashbury district for a summer of free love, counterculture, protests, and drugs. White Rabbit was a perfect soundtrack to this movement. It seemed to be celebrating the growing psychedelic culture. So naturally, it became a battleground in American society. The older generation detested White Rabbit, and that hate only helped propel it to anthem status for the youth. For many in the hippie movement, Alice in Wonderland provided a perfect allegory for their experiences. Of course, this was helped by the psychedelic imagery of Lewis Carroll's book and the 1951 animated Disney adaptation. In an article for the Wall Street Journal, Slick talked about this association. "I identified with Alice," she said. "I went from the planned, bland 50s to the world of being in a rock band without looking back. It was my Alice moment, heading down the hole." Grace documents this Alice moment in the second verse of White Rabbit.
"And you know you're going to fall. Tell 'em a hookah
White Rabbit is just as much a protest song against authority as it is a drug song, something that comes through in the third verse. There, Slick borrows chessboard imagery from Carol's story to create parallels with the authority figures telling the youth what they should and shouldn't do, and who they should and shouldn't be. The musical structure of White Rabbit taps into the growing psychedelic movement too. The song doesn't really have verses or choruses, it's just one progression towards a triumphant climax. The structure evokes Alice's journey into Wonderland, or a drug trip. In this way, music celebrates the independence that Alice finds in Wonderland, escaping her own world and finding her own courage, and becoming 10 feet tall. As we shift from a minor key to a major, Slick belts out the song's most iconic line. It's an enigmatic line that could simply mean to be aware of the world around you, to take in information and question the figures ruling your life. But many also took it as a celebration of drugs like LSD. Feeding your head was expanding your mind with these emerging psychedelics. Reading this song as an overt celebration of drug culture is easy, but Slick has said that she intended the song to be more nuanced than that. She wrote it as a criticism of the older generation who condemned their children for smoking marijuana and taking LSD, while they themselves were taking substances of their own in the form of caffeine, alcohol, and prescription medication. Furthermore, Slick said that the parents primed this generation for drug consumption through the stories they read as a kid. She told the Wall Street Journal, "They also seemed so unaware that many books they read to us as kids had drug use as a subtext. Peter Pan uses fairy dust and can fly. Dorothy and her friends in The Wonderful Wizard of Oz cut through a poppy field and wind up stoned and fast asleep." And then of course there's Alice in Wonderland, where she drinks concoctions and runs into the denizens of Wonderland, who are themselves drug consuming. The hookah-smoking caterpillar is even specifically named in White Rabbit. The late 1960s were a confusing time for American culture, a time of exploration and confrontation. And I think that's why White Rabbit resonated so well with the hippie generation. It didn't shy away from referencing the drugs that were changing their lifestyle at the time, but it also pushed back against the older generations. These lyrical themes were paired with music that fit the psychedelic aesthetic perfectly. There's a timelessness to the bolero beat, but the slow, crawling guitar explores dark, spacey places throughout the song. On top of this, Slick's powerful vocals drive the song home and give it a triumphant climax. White Rabbit was the perfect recipe for a psychedelic song, and that's why it's lasted so long. It's a page out of a history book, forever associated with a specific time, a specific place, and perhaps most of all, a specific feeling. It probably goes without saying that the 1960s are one of my favorite historical periods. I've always been really fascinated with the hippie counterculture, and that's why I loved watching the Capturing Woodstock episode of Bright Now on CuriosityStream. Bright Now is an awesome documentary series that tells incredible short stories about science, culture, and world history. If you watch this channel enough, you probably already know the deal with CuriosityStream. They're an awesome streaming service dedicated purely to documentary content. They've got thousands of documentaries on a wide variety of subjects. And where CuriosityStream is targeted at higher budget documentaries, me and some other creators started Nebula, a place for smaller educational creators to try out new ideas free from the constraints of YouTube. This freedom let me experiment with my first video series, Led Zeppelin's Epics. In that series, I looked at Stairway to Heaven, Kashmir, and Achilles' Last Stand, which I consider to be three of the highlights of Zeppelin's illustrious career. If you want to check that out, you can now get access to Nebula when you sign up for a year of CuriosityStream. CuriosityStream loves supporting independent creators, so we worked out a deal with them where a year of CuriosityStream gets you access to Nebula as well. If you go to curiositystream.com/polyphonic, you can get that deal now. And that means, in addition to thousands of curated documentaries, you'll be able to watch all my videos early and ad-free, and watch the Nebula original series Working Titles, where creators like myself, Captain Midnight, and Patrick Willems look at our favorite TV title sequences. This is a really exciting deal, and I'm super stoked that CuriosityStream is supporting our content like this. So please just head on over to curiositystream.com/polyphonic and give it a shot.